Well, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Well, welcome to Wednesday evening. Yeah, thank you, Dave. That's another good one. Let's stand for prayer, please. Greg, would you lead us, please? Amen. You know, none of this works without faith, and that's what Miss Ledger spoke to us about last night in prayer meeting was faith, and it was really really important. Sometimes when it's just a small group like it was last night, it makes just a little bit more of an impression on me. And I thank you, Miss Ledger. It was something I needed to hear, and it's something that I talked about with a friend of mine in Tennessee today. It's funny how God works, because that was a topic of our conversation. But anyway, my point is, Sunday school has been growing, and the Sundays that you don't have to be here, there's a lot more people here. It's like tripled in size. So I'm thinking maybe some of you ought to start coming to Tuesday night prayer meeting too. I don't know what to say. I don't want to say it's not boring. but it's not. It's really a good thing. And all of you get prayed for on Tuesday night. A lot of you by name. So whether you're there or not, you get prayed for, but you ought to come every once in a while and just see and join in. All right. Reverend Ledger.
Amen. Good evening. And I agree fully that we can't spend enough time in prayer in this prayerless day we're living in. Amen. Well, with an upraised hand, I'll take a selection tonight. All right. Okay, go ahead. Page 2? Okay. Number 2. And it is our custom to stand while we sing this song. So please stand together.
Shall rise.
Yes, Will, your hand is up. 33. Sorry, Brother Wooten, you didn't have your hand up. Number 33, How Great Thou Art. Another one of the famous hymns of the faith.
Thank you.
drama that you add in there on that last verse. That's nice. And speaking of Sunday schools, this Sunday is going to be another good one. So everybody's invited to Sunday school there. We're leading up to the crucifixion of Jesus. So we're there Sunday morning. We'll be in the morning of the crucifixion. So pretty important. Palm Sunday. Anyone have any prayer requests? Have anything to be thankful for?
Thank you for the scriptures for the scene tonight.
Yeah.
How important it is. Excited.
Yeah.
Thankful to be here.
Yeah. Well, glad you're here, man. You're in a good spot.
You too. Pray for my daughter, my grandson.
Okay. Yep. Roberto?
Bobby.
Your family? Okay. Yes, sir.
I want to pray for everybody going out tonight to safely return home.
Okay. All right. Aaron?
I want to pray and thanks for the chance to be an usher. And I hope that I am able to do it well.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
Doug?
Yeah, pray for a young man, Aaron's age. His name is Christian. He doesn't know what his name means. He wants to know.
Sweet.
Okay.
And he finds out what his name means.
All right. Yeah.
Sweet.
Amen.
Sweet. Hallelujah. We have volunteers that were here for about 3 or 4 years. I don't know if you all remember Steve and Yah Korean, and he works on airplanes. And he called me a couple days ago and asked for prayer for Ja's sister. She's in Korea. And she has a pancreatic cancer. So Ja's trying to get her vaccine that she's able to travel, because you have the vaccine proof of it or you can't travel. So let's pray for Ja and her family in Korea, and the Lord will make a way for her to get there and spend a little time with her sister. She knows it's terminal.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
My brother-in-law, Mark Mayhew, had surgery yesterday, and he's doing very well, but still in intensive care. Appreciate your prayers for him.
Okay. Yes, sir. Joe?
For Brother Omar, he has special petition.
Okay.
His faith is growing.
Omar?
On that alley.
Yes, sir. William?
Travel mercies for Ben and Sharon Potak as they travel back up north.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Okay. Continue prayer for Dave Warren and everything he's going through. And, yeah, Steve?
I just can't say how thankful I am to stay here.
Yeah.
I said the four things I had before. So I got off the alcohol and tobacco, place to stay, a job, clothes, and my license back. I didn't have it for over 20 years.
Amen.
Today I got my first car back.
Amen.
Good deal.
I'm on my 5-1 riding that bicycle. I'll have to.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. That's all because of God in this place.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yeah. Chris?
I'm glad I got word today that I'm going to be able to get the first two vaccine shots this Friday.
Yeah. Brother in your family, his family, okay. Joe?
I have to pray for Brother Dave, because it's not easy being up there for the play, worship, and the personal life walk with God, and the stress of the effects that man goes under, and every day functionally. Give his heart out to the Lord, worship him with us. That takes a lot.
Okay, yeah, with Brother Dave, okay. Joe? Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Will?
I'd like to pray for all the guys here and all the staff and everybody that does all the stuff that they do. You know, there's a lot of people here, and it's a fairly calm place, and that's amazing with a bunch of guys all in the same spot. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dave.
Yeah. BJ?
I want to thank Brother Ledger and Brother Wooten for helping this place grow, along with the place in the back.
Yeah.
Continue to ask for blessings for the people that have established this place, for people that have testimonies like that coming from the center.
Yeah. Yeah, I give thanks for the to some of the people that don't, some people don't know that they do some things around here, like Miss Foster. Rhonda helps out sometimes on during the week up in the office. And
Sister Christina, the teacher?
Yeah, Christina, that's, I was trying to think. Miss Christina, she wasn't there. I was looking for her. Miss Christina, for that what she's doing with the GED class. That's, I don't know how many people's in it. I don't keep up with that, but I know she's doing it. And there was some people that were taking it to get their GED, and that's, you know, that's pretty important.
That's
a good thing. So, see, and Miss Ledger, and thank you for her. And I always thankful for Brother McFarland. There's a lot to be thankful for.
Amen.
All right, let's stand for prayer, please. Joe, would you lead us, please?
I'll do that. Father, we thank you. We worship you, my King. We adore you. Give you the honor, the glory, and honor to you, my Lord. Father, for every air that we breathe today, right now, and you're also in my presence, my Father. Thank you. I thank you for this holy place, God, as you pick this one by one by name, my God, to come here and fellowship with you, my King. Thank you for all our men, God, that's out there in the trenches, Father, fighting for our lives, Lord. We may learn the word of truth, learn the power and authority and the package of salvation, my King. We thank you for these men and our sisters as they intercede in prayer for us each and every day, Father. Right now, I'm like the man of God as he comes forward to bring the word tonight, my King. Use him as a vessel unto you through the holiness, Father. A vessel of power and authority, sound doctrine, and truth. Father, we thank you. We exalt you, my God. Father, we come tonight to give and not to ask. Father, give you the glory once again, my God. I pray in our hearts. There are no words that can describe or fathom your greatness, my Lord, or your glory, your majestic ways, my King. The divinity, Father. It's awesome. It's beautiful, Father. We can't live without it. At least I can, my God. So tonight I worship you, my King. Give you all the honor and the glory. Bless all of our men that have left this campus. Bless those that are coming through these doors. All our families on the outskirts, Father, that are going through the devastation of the plague, of sin, Lord, of brokenness. Even as Father, darkness, try to come into their lives, my King. Father, we pray for this country, your country. Rooted and grounded on your words, my God, on your principles, my Lord. Have your way, my King. Father, all our churches, all our pastors around the world, our evangelists, all our missionaries, my God, that are bringing the word of Jesus. At this most darkest hour of humanity, at this most darkest hour, Father, on this planet, the word of Jesus is still alive, is fresh, and is strong, Father, and it has a free course. And we thank you, Almighty King, for Jesus. Amen, amen, amen.
Amen.
Henry, please. Oh, blessed Father, blessed Lord Jesus, once more we come and we bow down at your feet, Lord. For in your presence there is fullness of joy, and we know there is nothing or anyone who compares to you. And we take pleasure, Lord, in worshiping you. And we ask, O Lord, that once again you would bless everyone in this building as you bless this offering. For we all need you. We all fell short of your glory. And we all love you, Father. We thank you forever, Father God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. That offering goes, I always forget, that offering goes to Guatemala, our ministry down in Guatemala with Brother Goodman, and get to say, we say a prayer for him too. He'll need some prayers. And I also wanted to thank the good Lord for letting Daniel fix my washing machine today too. That's something that needed to be done, and I appreciate that. Appreciate that. All right, Reverend Ledger's going to lead us in another song.
All right, one more song. Brother Wooten, what was your selection?
422.
Amen. Good. Jesus found me when afar I wandered, brought me pardon from the throne above, gave me peace that passes understanding, joy unspeakable and full. Time to open our ears and our hearts and see what Stephen has for us tonight from our Lord. Stephen?
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Just going to talk a little tonight about living a life of satisfaction. And I'm not going to keep you long tonight, but it's good stuff, and I pray that each one here is able to receive it. Lord, we thank you for tonight, Father. We thank you to be able to gather in your house tonight. We thank you for your presence here tonight, Lord God. And Father, I just ask that you give me the words and the message tonight that you've given me and help me to present it clearly. And Lord, I ask that you would open up hearts and ears to receive your message tonight, Lord. Your truth out of your word, Lord God. Oh, Lord, your word that keeps us alive and keeps us going that we cling to. I ask it in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
All right. A little introduction. It's going to be about Psalms 23. And first, I want to tell you that people can have all the things of the world and not be satisfied. Amen. And that's from Ecclesiastes 5:10. It isn't just money that doesn't truly satisfy it. There's nothing that can truly satisfy apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. There are hungers that people are seeking to satisfy that they never really get satisfied. We all know about that. And even when we think we're satisfied, even that satisfaction is a dissatisfaction. There is a secret of satisfaction, and it is found in Psalms 23. The psalm that's been quoted in the nursery school and on the battlefield. It's been quoted at weddings and at funerals. It's sweet to a little child and yet perplexing to a scholar. It is sweet to, it has been said that the Word of God is deep enough that scholars can swim in it without ever touching bottom, and shallow enough that little children can drink from it without fear of drowning. So tonight I just want to talk a little about Psalms 23. And let me go there first. It's mainly about Psalms. Everything we're going to talk about is taken from Psalms 23:1. But I want to read Psalms 23 tonight. It's the Psalm of David. And David, who knew the Lord intimately, and you know, the Lord really loved David. They had a really special relationship. And that's what we're supposed to have. We're supposed to have a really special relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. He's our shepherd and he's our God. He's everything. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. You know how many times I tell myself that? And you know, it's the truth. No matter what you think you want or what you need, most of us that follow the Lord, I would say everybody that follows the Lord and has that right relationship with him has everything that you need. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. And he restores my soul. Yes. Oh, wow. Does he ever? Yes. You know, so many here, we know he does restores our soul. Yes. He leads me in the paths of righteousness, and that's for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. There's so much contained in this verse, Psalms 23:1, that we could take each word and emphasize that word. For instance, this verse says, the Lord, not a Lord, but the Lord. When David wrote this, the Egyptians had 360 primary gods. The Canaanites, in whose land the Israelites lived, also had many gods. David knew, however, that there is but one God, and that is the Lord. The word Lord refers to the great sovereignty, our eternal God and King. The word speaks to the eternal, unchangeable, and the immutable of our great God. The word my speaks to the personal relationship that we have with the Lord. My. The word shepherd shows that he is the one who is responsible for every care that the sheep might have. And that's just not some care or one care or two cares. He's responsible for every care. When we follow him and live for him and live with him as our Lord and Savior, he's responsible for every care that we have. We don't have to carry that responsibility. If we'll give it to him, he'll take care of it. The word shepherd, I just said that. As we look at Psalm 23:1, we will see the secret of satisfaction. We all want to live a satisfied life. We all don't want to be tossing and turning and wondering what we're going to do and where we're going to go and what should I do and how am I going to live? How am I going to quit drinking? How am I going to quit taking pills? How am I going to quit doing this? How am I going to find a job? As we look at Psalms 23:1, we will see the secret of satisfaction, because it says, I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. All right, the sovereign God of Psalms 23:1, the Lord is our sovereign God. In the King James Version, which most of us read here, it's recommended, the word Lord is capitalized. This word is a translation of an Old Testament name for God that is the most sacred name of deity, and this word is Jehovah. This name was so sacred to the Jewish people that some Bible historians say that it was only pronounced one time a year, and it was pronounced at that time when the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies and whisper the name, Jehovah. The high priest would go into the behind the curtain once a year. Nobody else could go there to meet with God. When a Jewish scribe came to the word Jehovah, they didn't have printers back then. Everything that was written about the Bible was written by hand, and there were certain people that did that, and they're scribes. When they came to the word Jehovah while translating scripture, he would get a brand new pen just to write Jehovah. That's how much reverence. Jehovah is the covenant-keeping God. Amen. He is the self-existing one. He is the great I am. Yes. He is the Lord, our shepherd. Yes. The creator of the world is our shepherd. David says that the great Jehovah is our shepherd. And you know, that's a hard thing, really, unless you know the Lord, to put together. The great God of the universe, the creator of heaven and earth and everything, is God, is our shepherd. And we're to have an intimate relationship with him. The Jehovah of the Old Testament is the Jesus of the New Testament. When we say Jehovah, we speak of his deity. When we say shepherd, we speak of his humanity. In John 10:11, in John 10, the Lord Jesus unlocked the mystery of Psalms 23, and when he said that he is the good shepherd, he is the sovereign and the shepherd, he is deity and humanity. That's deep. In the Lord Jesus, we have sovereignty and sympathy, a king and a shepherd. We have a God who is able and a shepherd who is available. We have a God in the heavens and a shepherd in our heart. Three times in the New Testament, the Lord Jesus is described as a shepherd. He is the good shepherd. In John 10:11, any shepherd may lose his life for the sheep, but that isn't what Jesus said. The good shepherd laid down his life for the sheep. No one has ever chosen to die but Jesus, because he is the only one who didn't have to die. He chose to die for us because it was the only way for our atonement for sins and for salvation. John 10:18, it wasn't nails that held Jesus to the cross, but the silver cords of love and the golden bonds of redemption that held him there. When as the good shepherd Jesus laid down his life for the sheep, he dealt with the penalty of sin. Romans 6:23 says that Jesus paid the wages for our sin. Your sin will either be pardoned in Jesus or punished in hell, but will never be overlooked. Amen. So when you sin and when you continue to live in sin, you may think, well, it doesn't really matter. But it does matter, because it's either one or two things are going to happen with it. If you don't repent and turn to Jesus, you're going to be punished in hell for your sins. And if not, they'll be pardoned. The Lord Jesus is the great shepherd. And in Hebrews 13, 20 through 21, the passage speaks about it. He rose from the dead for the sheep. And I want to go and read now in Isaiah. And if you want to follow, that's fine. If you don't, it's Isaiah 53, 1 through 6. This verse isn't in the Torah, in the human, in the Hebrew Bible, the Torah they use. This verse was removed. It's never put in there. And the reason for it is because they don't believe that Jesus was the Messiah. So they don't want people to read about it. And he who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness. And when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And we hid, as if were our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteem him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. And all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people, he was stricken. And that's Isaiah prophesying about Jesus. And that's not in the Torah. It was taken out so that it wouldn't know about Jesus. Jesus took the penalty of sin when he carried our sins to the cross. But when he rose from the dead, he dealt with the power of sin, a resurrection power. But not only is he the good shepherd, he's also the great shepherd. He rose from the dead. Amen. He's able to lead us in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Not just that he died for us, but he lives for us. The Lord Jesus is the chief shepherd. 1 Peter 5:4. And one day he is coming to take us from the presence of sin. Well, one day we won't have to live in this sinful world any longer. In Psalms 22, we find the crucifixion of Jesus. It is written as if a person were standing at the foot of the cross. We see the gambling for his garments. We have the words that he would say on the cross, the piercing of his hands and feet, the words of his enemies. We see the good shepherd dying for the sheep. In Psalms 23, we find the great shepherd leading his sheep, the one who is alive and risen from the dead. In Psalms 24, we find the great shepherd coming for his sheep. This King of glory is Jehovah. All right, the sovereignty of the shepherd in 23:1 says too, in this passage of scripture, we have the sovereign, who is Jehovah, and we have the shepherd, who is Jesus. Jesus is the Jehovah shepherd of our lives. The sovereign plus the shepherd leads to satisfaction. Let's say that again. The sovereign plus the shepherd leads to satisfaction. This is the only way that anyone will ever have any satisfaction in this world, is that you have the sovereign God and the shepherd, and he is both. That's the only way to be satisfied. It's the only satisfaction I've ever found complete in my life. And he does satisfy me completely, and he satisfies my life, you know? I'm very grateful to have the Lord give me that satisfaction of life. That's why a lot of times you think, I'm just a la-la lander, you know? Cheerful. No, it's because I got the Lord, you know, and I know it, and he's with me, you know, and what do I have to worry about, you know? I don't have anything to worry about, you know, I have the Lord, and he's going to help take care of all of it. This is the only way that anyone can ever have any satisfaction. We will never have satisfaction until we can say it and mean it. The Lord is my shepherd. And if you can't say that and mean it completely in your heart, and have that covenant with God, you know, you're not going to have that. But this is not the secret of satisfaction. The secret of satisfaction is the Lord himself. Our needs will never be met until they're met in him. Things will never satisfy. When we delight in the world, the deepest needs of our heart will be met. And I found that to be very true. The desire of our heart is Jesus. We were made for him. It is not what he gives us, but he himself. We were created for God, and until we know him, we will be like a square peg in a round table. And that's the truth. Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, David took the sacred name Jehovah and joined it to another name. There's seven times in the Bible where the name Jehovah is conjoined with another word to make a new name. I used to know how to pronounce every one of them. I don't anymore. And I asked Jerome, he didn't know. So we, on Google, we got him to pronounce one, but we couldn't get him to pronounce another one. So some I know I'm going to pronounce correctly. The rest of them you're going to have to bear with me, okay? And you can look them up, or I'll give you a sheet of them if you want. Under the inspiration, okay, there are seven times in the Bible, Jehovah Ra, that's in Psalm 23:1, Jehovah my shepherd, Jehovah Jireh, Genesis 22, the Lord my provider, the Lord will provide, Jehovah Raha, Exodus 15, the Lord who heals, Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace, Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. Jehovah Shammah, Ezekiel 48, the Lord is ever present. Jehovah Nisi, the Lord is our banner. The banner over us should be the Lord. In Psalms 23, all seven names for God are used. The Lord is my shepherd, Jehovah Ra. I shall not want. Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide. He restoreth my soul. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. He makes me lie down in green pastures, leads me beside the still waters. Jehovah Shalom, my peace. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Jehovah Nisi, the Lord our banner. Isaiah 59, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Jehovah Shammah, the Lord ever present. David was saying that the Lord is my shepherd, not the things that he gives me. The things that he gives me are only a representation of who the Lord is himself. If you want to know if the Lord is your shepherd, then ask yourself, is the shepherd my Lord? And this passage of the Lord Jesus is talking to the unsaved Pharisees in a personal relationship. I'm going to read in John 10:27. I may read a little more. This is John 26 through 27. I may read 28. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. As I said to you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one. All right. Hold on and don't bite me for this first one statement I'm going to make, because I'm going to correct it afterwards. We are eternally secure in Jesus. We don't have eternal security forever, though. Hold on. If we continue to stay and to stay in a covenant relationship and live a holy and blameless life, if we could be saved for 10 years and then lose our salvation, then that would be a 10-year life, but it wouldn't be eternal life. If we could be saved for 50 years, then lose our salvation, then that would be a 50-year life, and that it wouldn't be eternal life. So if you backslide and leave the Lord and quit leading a holy and blameless life before Him, you lose your salvation. And that's a battle with people, because we're taught, so many people are taught that, once you got your salvation, once you're saved forever. But when you dig into the Bible and you really hear everything, that's not the truth. I have family members that I can't even argue this with. We all have people we know that believe in eternal security, which is once saved, always saved. But the Bible is clear that as long as we walk in the Lord in a covenant relationship and live for Him and obey Him and follow Him and live a holy and blameless life, we do have eternal salvation. But when we turn our back on that life, we lose our salvation. It is a protected relationship. When we get saved, we come into the almighty hand of Almighty God. We're saved by the grace of God, and we're kept by the grace of God. In the shepherd are the wellsprings of your heart's desire. And in conclusion tonight, I want to say the Lord is a good shepherd. He laid down His life for His sheep. He died for you. He died. He rose from the dead to guide us and to lead us. The Lord is a chief shepherd. He is coming soon, and you need to be ready. There's plenty of scriptures and enough preaching here. You all hear about salvation, the message of salvation. There's plenty of scriptures. You know where to go to. Talk to somebody here, a minister, a preacher, about salvation. The altar is always open during the services. There's only one way to live a satisfied life, to be right with the Lord and be able to say and feel the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. All right, Dave's going to come forward, and I thought we'd sing a couple of songs. Let's turn to page 456.
I read the prayer of Jesus and said,
over to page 468. Thank you all for your kind attention tonight. I hope you receive something from the Lord tonight. Amen. Brother Wooten, would you close this in prayer, please?
We're thankful tonight, dear Lord, that we can come to a point in our Christian life where we have no desire to go back. Yes. And Lord, we pray tonight that you would look down upon the words that have been spoken. We're so thankful, Lord Jesus, tonight. You are our shepherd, and because you are, we have no wants. Lord, we pray tonight that you would bless this message to the men's hearts, to our hearts, dear Lord, and continue to help us to walk before you. We pray and ask in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. Amen.